In this presentation, we will be presenting a case of metastatic prostate cancer with obstructive uropathy. Metastatic prostate cancer patients have varied clinical presentation, of which one such presentation is with obstructive uropathy. This type of presentation is very important because these patients do present in emergency with uremic symptoms, and they have very high urea and creatinine levels, and this can be life-threatening as well. Hence, such type of patients should be promptly treated to prevent any catastrophe. Coming to the index case, here is a 68-year-old male who is actually a follow-up case of metastatic prostate cancer, who was diagnosed in February 2019. And at that time, he had both multiple bony as well as lymph nodal metastasis. He was offered hormonal therapy and chemotherapy. However, he opted only hormonal therapy for him. Hence, he was started on injection pamarilin and he took the treatment for 1 year. After that, because of the COVID pandemic since March 2020, he was lost to follow. This is the CT scan image which was done at that time in 2019, where you can see a large prostate which has invaded the trigone region, and you can see this hugely enlarged prostate gland in him as well. And the most interesting finding in him is that he had a bulky pelvic lymphadenopathy. Generally, metastatic prostate cancer patients, they generally present with bony mets, and in such cases, if you look into the PET images or the CT images, the pelvic and retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy is generally very less in bulk. But here you can see a huge pelvic inflows to the size of around 6 to 7 centimeters, involving the region of the common iliac vessels, and then the same lymphadenopathy extended into the pelvis, into the external iliac group as well as the obturator group. And this is one such rare case where you can see such a huge lymphadenopathy. Subsequently, after taking hormonal therapy, as I already told that he lost to follow, and now he presented to us recently with intermittent episodes of gross painless hematuria and also with obstructive lower urinary tract symptoms. He was again evaluated and we found that he had a large growth in the trigone with bilateral hydroureteronephrosis, and his hemoglobin was very low to the tune of 5.5 gram per deciliter, for which he was optimized by giving 5 units of rapid red blood cell transfusion. His serum creatinine was 2.1 and his serum PSA was 162 nanogram per ml. This is the latest CT scan which was done when he presented to us. Now you can see there are two interesting findings in this. One is that you can see there is no bulky lymphadenopathy at this point of time. Completely the lymph nodes were disappeared. So that is what an interesting point in this case, that after giving hormonal therapy, the response is very good. And you can hardly see any lymph nodes here in this CT at this point of time. Of course, you can see for the resident, it's very important to see that the bilateral ureters are dilated till the level of the bladder, where you can see on the right ureter, as pointed out by the arrow, where it is entering here. And on the left side, the ureteric orifice is still dilated here. And this is the mass in the trigone region. And that left ureteric orifice was actually opening into the mass actually on the left side. So this mass is actually continuous in the trigone region till the prostate. This suggests that this is actually the prostatic malignancy which has invaded the bladder rather than a separate bladder tumor. And he was again started on hormonal therapy now, and because of hematuria, bladder irrigation was started. And now how to manage him now? So see a prostate patient with bilateral hydroureteronephrosis with raised serum creatinine. Generally, unlike BPH, where after placing a catheter, the serum creatinine tends to improve, but in prostate cancer with trigonal infiltration, the periurethral catheter doesn't help in improving the serum creatinine. Even the hydroureteronephrosis will not resolve because the prostate cancer actually infiltrates in the subtrigone region till the level of the ureteric orifice. Hence, the only way to relieve obstruction in them is placing a bilateral PCN, and then subsequently, when once the serum creatinine stabilizes, the patient can be planned for transurethral resection of the trigonal growth as well as the bilateral ureteric orifice, and then an attempt for bilateral TJ stenting can be made. However, our patient was actually not willing for PCN, and also in view of persistent hematuria, a decision was taken for transurethral resection. So this is the intraoperative video. An interesting finding in this video is that on scopy, you can see the prostatic fossa and the prostatic urethra, there is no growth at all. However, when once we cross the bladder neck, you can see that large trigonal growth, which is like a mushroom and a solid looking hypervascular, completely invading the trigone region. And it is actually starting from the bladder neck into the trigonal region. You see how much hypervascular it is, solid looking. And then when we go beyond that mass, you can notice the trabeculated bladder there. However, as expected, you can't even identify where the ureteric orifices are. So this is the finding. And after resecting using bipolar technique, now you can see in this video at the cephalic end, you can see after resecting the right ureteric orifice. So this is the right ureteric orifice which was identified, and then subsequently the resection is continued. So all the growth which is seen all around the ureteric orifice is resected using cutting current, and of course simultaneously hemostasis is done. So this is the bipolar resection we are doing using normal saline, and then again after some time we identified the left ureteric orifice as well. So this is the left ureteric orifice. So you can see from the bladder neck till the proximal end, you can see a flat, that entire growth has been resected, and all the resected specimen was taken out. So this is the left ureteric orifice, and now the right ureteric orifice is seen. So after this, the next step is considering placing a stent. So hemostasis is achieved always from the beginning till the end, and then a right side ureteric stenting is being done here. After this, of course, the left side DJ stenting has been done already. So that is the left side DJ stent. So this is the final picture. You can see the both the ureteric orifice there with the stents and a flat trigone without any mass. And of course, hemostasis is done at the end of the procedure. It is very important to do fulguration of the margin of the mucosa. So this is the resected specimen. Total resection time was around 135 minutes. The few tips while resecting such large growth in the bladder: always prefer to go for bipolar resection because the risk of TVAR syndrome will not be there, and you have to plan and resect such large tumors. So you should always start from one side of the tumor, then at that side resect the growth till the base, do hemostasis, and then move to the next area. Don't try to superficially cut the entire tumor from left side till right side, because the bleeding will continue because the major vessels are seen at the base. So this will lead to loss of vision, loss of orientation, even it might land up in clot retention, even conversion to open surgery as well. So that's why it is very important to start at one side, go till the base, do hemostasis, and then only move on to the other side. So maintaining orientation and simultaneous hemostasis is the crux of such type of surgery. Always use cutting current when you are resecting at the level of ureteric orifices. Hence, coming to the finally to the learning points. So here is a case of metastatic prostate cancer, which has invaded the trigone without having any growth in the prostatic urethra, leading to obstructive uropathy. So that is what is classically seen in prostate cancer, where the prostatic cancer invades the bladder subtrigonally below the mucosa till the level of ureteric orifice. This is one important learning point for the residents. And of course, transurethral resection helps in treating recurrent hematuria. It also treats lower renal tract symptoms, like in this case, the patient had obstructed LUTS, which had improved after surgery. And also it relieves the ureteric obstruction by placement of DJ stents, and the morbidity of PCN can be avoided in such cases because these patients are generally elderly, and when you place PCN in them, the morbidity of PCN would be there, that it has to carry the nephrostomy tube. Sometimes the tubes can get blocked, leading to fever, and they can come out. So that morbidity would always be there. So that can be primarily you can avoid in them, leading to less chance of infection in these patients. Only PCN should be considered whenever there is obstructive uropathy associated with urosepsis. Otherwise, an attempt of transurethral resection always helps in such patients. Thank you.